Hi, I'm Danny Lacey, filmmaker from Leeds, UK. Thank you very much for watching this video blog. Do check out my website, dannylaceyfilm.co.uk. Hoping you'll find loads of interesting bits and pieces on there about filmmaking, including details of some of my film projects and links to other websites of mine, including Twitter, at Danny Lacey Film, my YouTube channel, Vimeo, Tumblr, IMDb, Facebook, and so on. Talking of Facebook, I set up a new Facebook page all about the filmmaking journey. It's called The Filmmaker's Journey, and it's taken advantage of the brilliant timeline feature on Facebook. It's like a big, long diary. It goes right back to 2009 when I started the filmmaking journey, right through to the present day. And again, it's packed full of videos, pictures, behind-the-scenes stuff that you might find interesting if you're into the whole filmmaking thing. So the subject of this video blog is DCP, Digital Cinema Package, and I've had to get my hands dirty with DCP recently because I got my premiere screening night coming up soon, and I wanted the best possible digital representation of the film, and I discovered that the cinema house has a brand new 2K digital projector, and so I wanted to use that. What is DCP? Again, Digital Cinema Package. It's basically, this is the technical term, a collection of digital files used to store and convey digital cinema audio, image, and data streams. So basically, it's a structure of organized into a number of MXF files. Now, if you're familiar with cameras like the C300, you'll be used to the MXF filing system, which is just basically a wrapper file. And that's used to store audio and video streams and auxiliary index files in XML format. Things worth considering with DCP is that they have and they use mainly two standard resolutions for 2K and 4K. There is the 1.85 aspect ratio and the 2.39 aspect ratio, which seems to be the industry standard. Some of the DCP servers will accept different sizes, but those two seem to be the main ones. So for 2K, if you're shooting at a 1.85 aspect ratio, you're going to need to be working at a 1998 by 1080 resolution. Or if you're working at 2.39 aspect ratio, which is what I'm using on my films, then you're going to be working at a 2048 by 858 screen size. For 4K, 1.85 aspect ratio will mean you'll need to work with the resolution of 3996 by 2160. And for 2.39 aspect ratio, you're looking at 4096 by 1716. Very important to give that some consideration before you even start filming. If you're going to be filming and you know you're going to be ending up with a 2.39 aspect, then you need to be thinking about that before you start filming. I know that some DCP servers will play back at 1920 by 1080, but you'd need to look into that. And the video is encoded at as JPEG 2000 image sequence. Something worth considering as well, if you are thinking about going on Academy Awards project, then there are certain specifications that you must adhere to if you're going to be sending over a DCP. It needs to be 24 frames per second. 2K runs at that resolution, 2.48 by 1080, but you can use other sizes as well. And but anyway, there are loads of useful information there. So again, something that you really need to be thinking about before you start shooting your film. Give that some consideration. So why do I need a DCP? Well, again, I've got the premiere screening night coming up, and I need the very, very best possible digital quality of this film. I didn't want to play it back on Blu-ray or via my laptop or HD Cam SR or any other format. I wanted to go all out, and DCP was going to be the way. My main concerns a few weeks ago would have been the fact that DCP is, by all accounts and from my knowledge, the very limited knowledge I've got on DCP, is that it's very expensive. We're talking thousands to have a DCP package put together. But that is no more. Wendy at the Hyde Park Picture House, she very, very kindly introduced me to OpenDCP, which is a free online software. It's open source, and it's basically brilliant. And it covers pretty much all the industry standard for DCP. And you can see that it's got different versions as well. It's got Linux, Windows, and the Mac 64, which is the version I was using. You just click on that link, download it and install, and you should end up with that lovely little icon there, OpenDCP, which is very nice. Very handy website. I'll put the link to this on the blog, by the way, so you don't need to worry about making the note too many notes. There's a forum on there, a frequently asked questions page, and loads of other bits and pieces as well, but completely free, open source. No longer is it going to cost you thousands and thousands and thousands to have a good quality DCP package put together. And remember, I've tested this already, and you're going to see a video a little bit later in this video blog of us actually using the DCP at the picture house, so you can see it working, and it works seamlessly. I've not had any problems, although by all accounts there are the odd bug here or there in this bit of software, but I haven't experienced that, touch wood, just yet. So there you go. So that I'll put the link to that on the website. I do want to credit this website before I go any further, mattcameronfilm.co.uk. I used this for to help me go through the whole DCP process. It's the first time I've ever done anything to do with DCP, and so this site was very, very useful. So do check it out and have a little look through. All the information I'm giving you is pretty much based on what is on this website. So a big thank you to Matt. He's on Twitter as well. I'll put the link up on screen for you. So mattcameronfilm.co.uk. Right, moving on. Let's get started. So working with OpenDCP, the first process is always going to be housekeeping, setting up the folder structure, and you're going to need quite a few folders for this to keep it simple and to reduce the amount of stress. So this is my host folder. In there is everything that is associated with my film host, all the sound files, all the capture files, the project files, everything. And I've also got a master folder. And in there is all the different exported versions of the film, H.264 masters, DVD, web, and so on. And there's a folder in there called DCP. Now, I've set these folders up. You may set your own folders up and title them slightly differently, but this made life a little bit easier. There's an After Effects folder, an audio export, JPEG 2000, master DCP deliverable. That's going to be the final process. That's the final master folder. An MXF folder and a TIFF export folder. So have some kind of folder set up in place. It will make your life a load easier, especially when you're dealing with thousands of TIFF files and JPEG files. And just keep that in mind. Definitely worth sparing a couple of minutes to get that set up properly. Right, we're going to start in Premiere Pro. I'm working in Premiere Pro and Adobe Audition, by the way, and I'll explain why. After Effects and Premiere Pro, and I'll explain why I have to use After Effects in a moment. So in Premiere Pro, we have, this is the locked edit of my film host, working in a 1920 by 1080 resolution. But what I need to do is I need to get that into a 2048 by 1024 resolution. So what I've done is I've set up another sequence, and I've also set up in my projects pane, I've set up a DCP sequence folder, and in there goes my newly named DCP sequence. Now, this sequence is 2048 by 1024, so that's one of the industry standards for DCP at 2K, okay? So that's a 1.85 aspect ratio. I'm going to crop it to 2.39, but I'm not going to do that until we go into After Effects. So I've set up the timeline at 2048 by 1024. See, even I'm getting confused by all these numbers now, so I hope you're making notes. All I've done is I've copy and pasted a little section of the film and then just pasted it onto this timeline. Just for this example, obviously, for the proper thing, I'd have the whole film in there. And we're not going to be exporting audio, so we don't need to worry about that too much. It's just going to be the picture that is exported. So that's pretty much all we need to do in Premiere Pro. Now, just taking a couple of steps back, Host was shot on the Red Epic, so I'm dealing with 5K files here, which means we're downscaling the video to fit into the 2K resolution. If you're working in a 1080p resolution, you're going to need to upscale by 7%, I think it is, but you're not gonna, it's not gonna affect the picture quality too much. Again, remember, I've seen and tested the footage already. I did that day in host. That day was shot at 1080p, upscaled 7% to fit the frame size, and it looks fine. There's no real issues with it. If you had to upscale any more than that, then obviously you're going to start having problems. But so yeah, if you're working at 1080p, you're going to need to increase by 7% to fit the frame size. Hope that makes sense. So we're done now in Premiere Pro, so we now flip over to After Effects, and the first job is to import that sequence. Now I create an Adobe Dynamic Link here. You can obviously import an Adobe Premiere Pro project, but I found it easier to do it this way. So Adobe Dynamic Link, import Premiere Pro sequence, go to the folder where your Premiere Pro project is, and that's this one here. Then the folder I set up earlier, DCP sequences, select the project, the DCP project, click OK, and there we are. Now, before I go any further, the reason I'm having to use After Effects is when exporting, because we're going to be exporting, the next phase is to export the film as a TIFF sequence. So a sequence of images, TIFF images, but they need to be 16-bit to get the best quality out of it. And unfortunately, I haven't found a way to be able to do that in Premiere Pro. So I've had to bring it into Adobe, into After Effects, because I know that we can change to 16-bit easily. And the way we do that is by clicking this button at the bottom here. So we need to change that to 16 bits. And I think I'm right in saying that 16 bits is the maximum you can use on DCP. I think 16 bits is as high as it'll go to. Correct me if I'm wrong, but that's pretty much what I've discovered so far. We don't want to work in 8 bits because it just means we're not going to get as good a quality. So 16 bit, very important that you get that bit sorted. Click OK. As you can see, we're now working in 16 bit. The next phase is to set up a composition. So we drag our Premiere Pro project down to our new compositions box. And there we go. We now have our film composition. In here, the first job is to now do our crop, our 239 crop, because at the moment we have this, the letterboxing, which is, and this is a 185 aspect ratio, don't forget, which is that 2048 by 1024 resolution. And doing the crop is very simple. Composition, down to composition settings, and then we just change the height to 858, which will, as you can see, give us the 239 aspect ratio, which is what we want. We click OK. Hey presto, there you go. Your film is now at the right resolution. Okay, we're now ready to export this as a TIFF sequence. So highlight with the sequence highlight, with the composition highlighted, we'll go to composition, make movie. So composition, make movie. That then gets sent to the render queue. And in there, we need to tweak a few of the settings. In the render settings, we won't need to touch anything in there. It might be worth just opening it up, just to double check that you've got best, full, and everything else is pretty much as it is. So we don't need to worry too much about that. In output module, this is where we need to do most of the settings changes. And there are some very important changes we need to make in here. First of all, we need to change the format to TIFF sequence. Okay, you've got all these different options. The only one we need is TIFF sequence. Now, if we were to export that as it is, it would only export an 8-bit. And this took me a little bit of time to work out why, but it's because of this setting here. It's currently set at millions of colors. That needs to be set at trillions of colors. Now it will export at 16-bit. Okay, so very important, don't overlook that. If you leave it set at millions of colors, it will only export at 8-bit. You need to change that to trillions of colors, which means that it will now get exported at 16-bit. And those are the only things that you need to change. You click OK. Choose your output destination folder. And what we're going to do here is go to one of our folders that we set up in the DCP folder. And that will be TIFF export. And then, and I've already done this, so they're all, the files are already there. I've set up a folder inside that, which is host DCP test, basically. And then you click save and render, and then that's what you end up with, a trillion TIFF files. So that's the process in After Effects. And that's pretty much it for After Effects and Premiere Pro. So we can hide both of those. And the next phase is to think about audio. Now, I'm not going to go into too much detail about the audio because that's a whole different blog video in itself. But in our audio export, you need to basically split all your audio files into individual tracks. So if you're working in stereo, you'll need stereo left and stereo right as separate channels, and they need to be mono channels. I'm going to be working with a 5.1 surround sound mix, so my dubbing mixer is sending over all the individual files that I need as separate files, all mono WAV files, 24-bit, 48 kilohertz, and they're labeled up clearly so we know what they are. That's the center, left, right, stereo, surround left, surround right, and sub. So just bear that in mind. Again, I'm not going to go into detail on how you create these files. It depends on what software, audio software you are using, but it's pretty straightforward. But make sure they're clearly labeled up as you need them. Okay, so that's the audio tracks. Now we need to open for the first time our OpenDCP software. So we click on the icon. And there we go, this is what we met with. Very straightforward. This bit is so very, very simple and straightforward. We're going to be working with this tab, the MXF tab, and the DCP tab. We're not, there's no subtitles on this film as yet, but that's there if you do need it in the future. First job is to convert our TIFF files into JPEG 2000, which is the codec that is used for this DCP process. You won't need to change very much on this page, apart from this, very important, the frame rate. It will work with a lot of different frame rates. We're working in 25 frames per second. So set that to whatever frame rate your video is at. And this, I leave it under 25 megabits, but if you're working in 4K, then you might want to increase that to get even better quality out of it. But I left it under 25 and it was fine. The threads, as far as I can tell, that's just how many cores you have on your processor. Leave the rest of it, don't touch any of that, that's fine. Input directories, so we now need to find the folder that's got all our TIFF images. So we open this up, we go to our host folder, down to master, DCP, TIFF export, and there's our folder, and those are all our TIFF files. We click choose, it tells us how many frames we've got, and that's that one done. Then we need to point it to another folder where it will place our newly converted JPEG 2000 files. And again, we go to the DCP folder, JPEG 2000 project folder. I've already done this, so I'm not going to bother doing that for this one, but it will go in there, and then you click convert, and it will do the converting. And then that's that job done. Next bit, we go over to the MXF folder. There are two things that need to be done in here. First of all, the JPEG 2000 needs converting to MXF, and then your audio files also need converting to MXF, so that'll be the WAV. But first, we'll do the JPEG 2000. Again, make sure you've got the right frame rate, 25 frames per second in this instance. Find the JPEG 2000 folder that's just been made, again, in DCP folder, in JPEG 2000, and in the project folder, and there are all the JPEG 2000 files. And we need an output folder. Where is it going to put the MXF file once it's finished? And again, because we're very organized, we have that folder already set up, and there it is. And you give it a name and you click save. I would save this, for example, as host DCP test 01 underscore video, and then click save. But I'm not going to do it in this instance because it's something that I've already done before. And again, output file, and then you click create MXF, and it's done. It will create one MXF file in that folder. Next step is the WAV, is the audio. If you're working in stereo, you'll just need to put stereo left, stereo right in this channel. But we're working with 5.1, so we need to put in all the various audio channels, tracks. So we go to our audio export, and in there you'll see all the different files clearly labeled up. Really important that you get the labeling right. So audio left, audio right, center, sub, left surround, and right surround. And then you point it to an output destination, which again is going to be in the DCP folder, MXF. Click save. All right, you want to remove, I don't know why it keeps that on the end, but you want to remove the .wav at the end. Click save and then create MXF. And then you should have two files in that folder, one video, One Audio. Final phase is to go over to DCP, the DCP tab, title of your film. I'm just going to very randomly type a lot of rubbish in here. Annotation, I've just been typing OpenDCP, issuer, I'm going to leave that blank. Kind, it's a short. Annotation again in there, just OpenDCP will do. Now this is where we need to find all the MXF files that we've just made. So first of all, the picture is going to be in our MXF file. There's nothing in there at the moment because I've not actually done that on this instance, but it'll be in there. You click OK, you point it, you find the sound MXF, which again is going to be in that same folder, and then you literally click Create DCP, and that is it. What you end up with in the master DCP deliverable folder, because you need to, because when you click Create DCP, it asks you where you want to put the DCP files. That's where you put it in the master DCP. And what you end up with is this: 6 files, 4 XML files, and then your video and audio MXF files. So XML and 2 MXF files. And then it is ready to put onto your hard drive. Now, again, I've read a lot into using DCP. And the majority of the sites I've read and people I've spoken to have said that you've got to, well, you've got to format the drive in a Linux format or EXT2 or 3. I took a USB-powered Mac-formatted hard drive and it worked fine. Apparently, I'm very lucky. Most DCP servers are very fussy, but I felt quite lucky. But the one thing you do need to consider is you can't go putting a load of files on the hard drive. Basically, you need to have that file in the root of the hard drive, root directory of the hard drive, so that it's just one folder and there are the files. Don't put them in subfolders. It won't recognize or find it. So the question is, did it work? The answer is yes, and unbelievably seamlessly. So here's what happened when I took the hard drive with the newly made DCP files on it to Hyde Park Picture House in Leeds. Right, so I'm at Hyde Park Picture House with Wendy. Hi, Wendy. And so I've made the DCP files. We're now with the DCP server, which is a Dolby server. And it works. It's actually loading it on, and there's Wendy, as you can see, and there is our, those are our clips loading on at the moment, which means we haven't had to format the hard drive to Linux or EXT3, I think was the other one. It just works off the bat, which is very, very handy indeed. We just plug in the USB hard drive into the server, which you probably can't see. It goes on the computer, and then that's the 2K projector. And how long have you had the server in?
We got it a year last February, About a year and 3-4 months.
Okay, and you pretty much play most of the films off of this system now?
A lot. I mean, when we first got it, we were still showing a fair bit of 35mm we got from the use of things. Now there's just, we're awash with DCP. We still try to show 35mm because obviously it's fantastic, but this has opened up kind of a world of possibilities in terms of, there's just so many good potential things with being able to show this, so we are doing a lot on digital.
Brilliant. And you've got, I mean, these are the beasts. These are the 35mm projectors.
Yeah, probably, so they're pretty beautiful.
They're antique though, so how old are they?
They're from about 1960.
Wow.
But they're fantastic. They kind of, they upgrade really well, so they work as well now as they did then.
Right.
And anything kind of changes, like digital sound, you can just upgrade them. So if you look sort of towards the front, you'll see where they've modernised
it. Oh yeah, so you can see some of the new attachments. It's the 1960s.
So there's a technology that kind of evolves nicely, whereas digital kind of is more newer, better.
So here it is. This is the beast. This is, and it's. Oops, sorry, is it? It is 2K maximum, this projector, is it? Or do you have the 4K?
This one's 2K. For the size of our auditorium, 2K is fine.
Okay.
You get a bigger auditorium, you want 4K.
Yeah.
2K, this space, perfect.
So our files are now loaded. They're in, and
so what we'll do is we'll have a look
So checking, selecting. Just switching everything on. And they've also got a super a 16mm projector as well, which is over this end. And DVD, Blu-ray.
And what ratio is your film in?
239. Yeah, it's 2048 by 858. So that's out into the cinema, as you can see down there. And so yeah, it's 2048 by 858, which I think is a one of the DCP standards, which I did check online, one of the things I did learn about. So just setting up the aspect ratio, is that something you have to do manually or does it automatically detect?
Well, what we do is, if it's a film we're kind of showing quite a few times, we'll set up a script which has lots of auto cues about lighting, volume levels, ratio. But for something like this where I've not done a script, we set it all manually.
Okay.
Have a look,
we'll
have an image on screen.
Wow. So there's the film on screen at the moment. Right, so going into the cinema, where my film is currently showing on the big screen right now. And there it is, in all its 2K glory. Wow. Oh my goodness, it looks great.
You son of a bitch. Come on, Paul. Answer the question.
That's brilliant!